August 1985, stiflingly hot. Harvest time in the Essex fields meant long hours and short tempers. But at one farm, the rural rhythm were about to be shattered by a horrific act of violence. At 3 in the morning on August 7th, a terrified young man called the local police station. He said his name was Jeremy Bamber.
Hi, my name's Jeremy Bamber from Goldhanger. You've got to help me. My father's phoned from Whitehouse Farm and he sounded really frightened. He says my sister's gone crazy and she's got a gun. But then the phone went dead. It sounded more like someone had cut the line.
Jeremy had phoned at Chelmsford Police Station up and said that there was something was amiss at Whitehouse Farm, so we just got in the police car and drove out there.
Bamber lived in the village of Goldhanger, 10 minutes away. He was 24 and worked on his parents' farm. He said he'd meet the police outside.
En route, we passed a white Nova that if it had been going any slower, it would have been stopped. We turn up at the farm, middle of the countryside, very dark, and the farmhouse is totally in darkness. As we're deciding what to do, the white Nova that we'd passed about 5 minutes previously draws up, and it's Jeremy Bamber driving.
Jeremy Bamber told them his family were in the house. Nevill and June Bamber, his adopted parents. Sheila, his adopted sister, and her 6-year-old sons, Nicholas and Daniel. He said Sheila was being treated for paranoid schizophrenia. He was afraid she'd done something terrible.
The way Jeremy was talking was there were a lot of guns in the house, that his sister, he used the expression, is nutty, and she'd not had a good time with the parents previously, and that he was worried that something might have happened. And he kept begging us to try and go in. And I thought, there's no way I'm going to go in there because you've got one of two things. You've got a lot of dead people or you've got a lot of dead people and a nutter with a gun. And there was no way I was going to go in there like that.
The house was silent. All Jeremy and the police could do was wait for the armed response unit. He drew them a map of where the family should be sleeping. And he pointed out possible hiding places where Sheila could still be waiting with a gun. At 7 a.m., the armed response unit broke in.
I went to the kitchen and saw Nevill Bamber. His injuries were really shocking injuries. Blood everywhere. Before the shots were fired, he put up a terrific struggle with the person responsible, and during which he received a lot more injuries. The first shots upstairs didn't kill him, but enough to injure him. The gun was used to hit him as well. He had marks in his back, round circular marks, which appears as if he'd been forced downstairs, where he was basically finished off.
Nevill had been the victim of a frenzied attack. And the police knew his killer might still be in the house. There were 4 family members unaccounted for, 2 women and 2 children.
I went upstairs and in the room upstairs I saw the 2 young lads. 6-year-old twins. They'd both been shot in the head several times. One has got a thumb in his mouth, so to me it appeared that they were both asleep when they were shot. Obviously didn't feel anything.
Both children had multiple gunshot wounds point blank to the back of the head. It was as if they'd been executed in their sleep.
I went upstairs to the master bedroom. June Bamber was lying on the floor near a door. She'd been shot in the bed and also on the floor.
It seemed as if a terrified June had been struggling to escape. But who from? The answer seemed obvious. Sheila Caffell, Jeremy's adopted sister, was lying dead, cradling the murder weapon.
She'd had two shots to her neck. I understand the first one wouldn't have been fatal, but would, I would think, possibly knock her out. She looked clean. Her nails were very well manicured. And to me, she looked just lay there peacefully like an angel.
All the windows and doors in the house were locked. The head of the police investigation thought it was clear. Sheila Caffell had murdered her parents and her own children in a psychotic frenzy. Then, in her anguish, she had turned the gun on herself. Now, someone had to break the news to Jeremy, who was still waiting outside.
I had to tell him that his sister, her two children, and his mother and father had been found in quite gruesome circumstances. You never expect anybody to react in a certain way because everybody's different and everybody reacts differently. He was quite laid back, but it was almost as if he was forcing himself to look more upset than he was. I just didn't like it. I had a funny feeling about him all the time.
Jeremy's overacting was also making Stan Jones suspicious.
I watched him and he appeared to be bending over as if he's trying to be sick. I kept thinking, is he trying to be sick or is it just an act? It doesn't seem right. He was hammered it up. It didn't look real.
By 9 a.m, the farm was swarming with helicopters and armed police. But the relatives still had no idea what was going on.
I just got in the car. I drove straight there. I drove straight to the White House, and there was a police officer at the entrance to the lane, cordoning the road off. And I said, excuse me, I said, could you tell me what the matter is? This is my aunt and uncle here. He said, I'm sorry, I can't let you through, and I can't tell you anything. And then about 5 minutes later, the next door neighbour came out of the drive, because they share the same driveway. And he said, I can't talk to you, it's too horrific, he said, it's awful.
The police asked the relatives to meet at Jeremy's house. They told them the terrible news. Sheila had murdered the family and then killed herself.
When I got to Jeremy's house, my sister came to the door and she said, I've got to tell you something. And she said that June and Neville were dead, Sheila and the children. And I couldn't take it in. I just could not take it in. I got to the point where I understood that Sheila was dead, but I just couldn't take it in. I went up to Jeremy and I gave him a loving hug and I said, "Oh my God, I'm so sorry."
The police brought Jeremy's girlfriend, Julie Mugford, to try and help comfort him. But the couple's behaviour raised more suspicions.
Then they had her to go into a separate room with Jeremy so they could talk to each other. I closed the door behind them. And I was in the waterway, I heard, I thought it was a laugh or a chuckle. And I thought, no, it must be a cough. And I thought, no, it can't be a laugh, surely. You know, someone lost all his family and he's laughing.
Stan Jones and the forensics team were so suspicious that they spent 2 days taking 200 forensic photographs of the scene. Their bosses had told them to just clear up the mess of 5 lives being ended brutally. As the coroner removed the bodies, the police started to question Jeremy more closely.
As we listen to Jeremy's comments to the police officer, we suddenly realise that quite a few things weren't quite ringing true. They asked him, did you have a loving relationship with your parents? And I can remember him saying, oh, yes, we have a wonderful relationship. And we knew it wasn't that special. You know, it was quite a fiery one. And there were lots of little comments that didn't quite ring true. My father was listening as well. And it wasn't until the next day my father said to me, "It's only what Jeremy's saying, isn't it?"
A family of five, including two small children, had been wiped out. Officially, it was case closed. But in the coming months, the police were to realise they'd made an awful mistake.
A niggling feeling at the back of your mind thought that perhaps she had really gone berserk and done it. But I did know that, in my heart, that it was Jeremy.
A family of five had been found brutally murdered. The police thought Sheila, their adopted daughter, had gone mad, shot them all and then herself. But suspicions were growing about her adopted brother Jeremy. Which of them had done it, and why? Nevill and June Bamber ran a farm near the small village of Tolshant Darcy in Essex. It used to be famous only for its apples and its annual maypole festival. Nevill and June were pillars of the local community. They were both church wardens, and Nevill was a magistrate.
Mr. and Mrs. Bamber were regarded as the squires of the village, very well respected. Like you would look up to your parents, village people looked up to Mr. and Mrs. Bamber.
Nevill was charismatic. He had a tremendous sense of humour. I can always remember Nevill loved a party. June, on the other hand, she was a much quieter person, shy, and the two of them were a perfect pair.
A lot of people said that she took religion perhaps a bit further than she ought, but that was her life and that's what she felt, and she respected religion and acted by it.
Their one great sadness was that they couldn't have children. So they adopted two babies from the local Christian Children's Society. First Sheila, and then 3 years later, Jeremy. June raised the children to be God-fearing Christians. At last, they had the perfect family. Or so they thought.
June was a lovely person. And Nevill was not a disciplinarian. I think it was open season for Jeremy. He could actually virtually say and do what he liked within reason. And he did abuse his mother, not physically, but verbally, quite a lot of the time.
He would say and do things that would upset her and seemed to take glee in it, really. She didn't like rats, and he put baby rats in his jacket pocket and then said to his mother, "Put your hand in here and see what I've got." And of course there were baby rats, which upset her greatly.
Nevill and June wanted to give the children the best of everything. They sent them both away to expensive boarding schools. At the age of 8, Jeremy was sent to Gresham School in Norfolk, 3 hours' drive from home.
I think he was surprisingly sharp-tongued and a bit arrogant. That was the reputation he had. He was a bit of a loner, not very popular or well-liked.
Gresham's was a prestigious public school, full of the children of the rich and famous. Jeremy had trouble fitting in.
Jeremy actually told a few of his friends in confidence that he was an adopted child, and children can be very cruel. And they made fun of it, and he was known as the bastard, apparently.
Jeremy deeply resented being sent away to school. He begged to come home, but his parents wouldn't let him. Even years later, he never forgave his mother for sending him away.
I think if you do feel just a little bit insecure in your own home, and then you're sent to boarding school, and top that with the fact that you are aware that you are adopted and that your parents didn't want you, the whole combination of it all must have been quite horrific for the poor little lad. Well, we're assuming that he's a poor little lad, right?
Kerry Danes is a consultant forensic psychologist. She studies what early events can put a child on the road to becoming a murderer.
It's likely that he felt incredibly rejected on many different fronts, and that this caused him to feel that he desperately wanted attention, he wanted to be loved, but that if he actually attempted to get this, he would be rejected again. This causes a terrible conflict for a child, and one way of coping with it might be simply to detach. You detach from your emotions so you can't be hurt. What could have happened is that the emotional switches in Jeremy's brain could have been permanently jammed in the off position.
But boarding school was just the beginning of Nevill and June's plans for the children. Jeremy was supposed to help Nevill on the farm and eventually inherit the business. Sheila, Jeremy's older adopted sister, was supposed to marry some nice local boy and bear them lots of grandchildren. Instead, they went to London and discovered a new world. The wild excesses of the mid-80s. Drugs, sex, and endless money. Sheila was supposed to be going to a finishing school in London, but she soon had other plans.
Sheila started modelling, and she was actually getting quite well paid for doing this sort of work. And then she went to places like Japan.
But the glamour and stress of modelling were getting too much for Sheila. She was finding it hard to make ends meet.
I think the lifestyle and the money, it sort of burned a hole in her pocket fairly quickly, and I think she found that she was spending more than she was probably actually earning. She wasn't really in the real world, I think. A little bit pleasantly senile in that she lived in a dream.
Instead of marrying a local farmer, Sheila got hitched to Colin Caffell, a penniless art student, and gave birth to twins, Nicholas and Daniel.
Motherhood meant an awful lot to her. You know, she had several miscarriages, and the more miscarriages she had, the more important natural motherhood meant to her. It was the most important thing in the world to her. She wasn't the most practical of people. She found a bit of a strain. She had a lovely relationship with the twins, and that was the most important thing to her.
Jeremy was at least working on the farm after a couple of dead-end jobs in pizza parlours. But he deeply resented being made to do a decent day's work for his mother. He was dreaming of escape. He wanted to live the lifestyle of his much richer friends.
He did live quite a high life. He was going up to Stringfellow's in London and clubbing it and having a little bit of a whale of a time. He was living way beyond his agricultural wages, that's for sure.
To pay for his extravagant lifestyle, Jeremy decided to do his own type of farming.
He was growing cannabis in the back garden and packaging it and doing a mail order business, I believe. So there we go.
Jeremy and Sheila's lifestyles deeply offended their mother, June. She coped with their rebellion by becoming more and more religious.
She couldn't forgive the way that they were behaving. She thought that they ought to behave decently because of the sort of family that they were. They would go against her wishes purely because they felt that they were expected to be decent people.
Jeremy even started doing the farm work in full new romantic clubbing gear.
I did see him at odd times dressed in various apparel and also makeup. Dear mommy, dear daddy, you have friends for me. Oh yeah, I was your only son. I think this was to shock people, and it was done to annoy Mr. and Mrs. Bamber, which it did.
Jeremy had started a relationship with a local girl called Julie Mugford.
He was a sexual predator. On his nights off from Julie, he was rampant around the bars and the clubs in southeast Essex.
And it wasn't only girls.
I did see him with other fellas, and if he saw you looking, then he would put his arm round and kiss them and really go to town to impress you. But it didn't seem genuine to me.
This could have been just youthful high spirits, or perhaps an indication of something dark.
It's possible that these are the early signs that in actual fact he has got psychopathic traits. So breaking rules, constantly breaking rules in many different ways, also being sexually promiscuous and really needing a high level of stimulation. They're very prone to boredom.
And for Jeremy, tormenting his mother was just another piece of entertainment.
She did have a new bicycle. He got the bicycle and he would ride round and round in circles round her so that she couldn't walk away, and she would tell him not to do it. But he did it all the more, which did upset her quite a bit. I felt he took glee in upsetting people, quite frankly.
And it wasn't only Jeremy who was distressing his mother. Just after the twins were born, Sheila's marriage to Colin Caffell fell apart, and she was left as a single mum. June was distraught.
I think it's the pressure of having to handle a daughter that had a broken marriage, a son that was actually not quite sizing up to what was hoped of him. I think the pressure of life for June was intolerable.
June had a breakdown and was treated at a mental hospital in Northampton. She was diagnosed with psychosis. Her religious beliefs had spiralled out of control. She saw the world only in terms of good and evil. Just as June was recovering from her mental breakdown, another tragedy struck. Sheila also had a breakdown and was confined to the same hospital in Northampton.
I think she was taking drugs, I think, at one point. And I think the combination of that and trying to look after two children on a very limited budget got too much for her. I think the psychiatrist said that she was hearing voices, I believe.
Sheila was diagnosed with paranoid schizophrenia. She thought she, her mother and her children were possessed by the devil. June and Neville bought Sheila a flat in London so she could recover. But Jeremy was still working on the farm, earning very little money. It was a recipe for disaster.
Jeremy didn't like that one little bit. He thought, there he was, working on the farm, to suddenly see Sheila sort of having a freebie flat bought for her, and I think she was being helped a little bit financially. Jeremy didn't like that one little bit. I think he was quite jealous, quite jealous.
Jeremy started pressurising his parents for more money, but they refused. Jeremy went out and bought a semi-automatic rifle. He told his girlfriend, Julie Mugford, that he was going to kill the whole family so he could inherit all the money.
I remember one occasion in particular when he said to me with quite a lot of vehemence that he'd get rid of all of the family, including Sheila and the boys, and he would do so by shooting them.
But most of the family had no idea of the horror that Jeremy was planning. Only Neville sensed that something was wrong. He finally confided his fears in Barbara, his secretary, but he made her swear never to tell a soul.
He then said that he wouldn't be at all surprised that his life was cut short in the near future, and he expected it would probably be a shooting accident. And I did think that, you know, if anything did happen, it would be Jeremy. I can see him sitting there telling me now, and he was upset. But he wouldn't burden me really with it, and that's why he said, don't worry about it, Barbara, he said, it might never happen.
But on the 7th of August 1985, it did.
There was an air of shocked silence in the quiet little village of Toll St. Darcy today as people went about their business, stunned by the news that all but one of this well-known family had met such violent deaths.
I really couldn't believe what had happened. You can't. It's just... It just doesn't seem real. And we heard that Sheila had possibly done this, and that I knew couldn't possibly be true, although a niggling feeling at the back of your mind thought that perhaps she had really gone berserk and done it. But knowing what had gone on beforehand and what Mr. Bamber and I had talked about, I did know that in my heart that it was Jeremy.
But for the press and most of the Essex police, it seemed simple. Sheila, Jeremy's schizophrenic adopted sister, had committed the worst crime imaginable. She'd killed her parents and her own children. It was an open and shut case. Only Stan Jones could guess the horrendous truth, that Jeremy Bamber had committed an almost perfect crime by framing it all on Sheila. But his colleagues disagreed.
I voiced my opinions and said I think Bamber's involved. At that stage, I was told, unless there's any other evidence forthcoming, they're still going to be treated as four murders and suicide. And being quite honest, for a month, I went through hell because I was leading what I called double life, I suppose, knowing that in my own mind that he'd committed all these murders, but trying to keep play ball with my job. I had to just pray that something else would come up very shortly to prove that I was right.
Stan sensed that Julie Mugford knew the truth, but no matter how often he interviewed her, she was still too frightened to talk.
I didn't think that at that stage anyone would believe me, and Jeremy was also so terribly confident that nobody could do anything about it, that he said there was nothing I could do anyway.
It looked like Jeremy Bamber had got away with it.
I was petrified when I saw him next time. I was really frightened because I thought that he could read my thoughts, and it does frighten you.
That feeling that he was still at large left us in a feeling of a little bit of insecurity. How safe were we? You know, who is going to be the next one on the list?
A week after the murders, a funeral was held for the family in the local church. Jeremy led the mourning.
I think he put up an incredibly good show. When he came out of the church, he was showing, he looked really upset, and you could see, I thought he got a few tears coming down, and I thought, yes, you're really upset about this. And the second that we were out of sight of the public, Jeremy turned his head round and gave the most enormous great beam. His mouth went, you know, talk about wide-mouthed frogs. We really had one. And my brother-in-law, at that moment, said, he did it, didn't he? He was actually an incredibly good actor.
I think that that is classic behaviour of a psychopath. I think that, in essence, Jeremy painted on his emotions, the emotions that he felt he should portray for that day. And then, when he felt that nobody was watching him, or nobody who mattered was watching him, he simply took the mask off and put it to one side.
Jeremy's performance at the funeral was the last straw. The relatives were convinced he'd committed the crime. They suspected the police hadn't searched the house properly because the crime had been put down as four murders and a suicide. So they decided to have a hunt around for themselves. In a cupboard, under the stairs, they found a vital piece of evidence. The silencer from the murder weapon.
I picked up the silencer and I noticed it was sticky. Sticky to your to the touch. We suddenly realised that there was a spot of blood. Only a small spot, but it was right at the end. We quickly put it to one side and it was sent off to forensic. We never heard any more about it, except that they were exceptionally interested in the results that they'd found.
Stan Jones was also digging deeper into the case. He found more evidence that had been ignored by the original investigation. Evidence that suggested Sheila couldn't have done it. Firstly, there was the murder weapon. It was a .22-caliber semi-automatic rifle. To kill the family, Sheila would have had to fire 25 rounds on target. And reload the gun at least two times.
If she had to load that cartridge twice with her long manicured fingernails, they'd have broken. There's no doubt whatsoever.
Firing the gun at moving targets would have taken skill and experience.
She'd never used a gun. She wasn't a gun-type person. She never allowed the twins to have toy guns.
Stan now had enough evidence to prove that Sheila was innocent. But with that firm evidence against Jeremy, he could still get away scot-free. Then Jeremy made his final mistake. He dumped Julie Mugford, the one person who could prove his guilt.
I kept on saying to him that I had to say something and I couldn't keep this in and questioning him. He became frightened of me, which is what made me become frightened of him, because he obviously was getting quite nervous about the fact that I wasn't prepared to just cover him, if you like, anymore. And it was the Saturday morning then that I went to the police.
She told us the whole story from beginning to end, how he'd planned to kill his parents. He wanted to do the whole lot in one go. He wanted the whole family to be there so he could get rid of all of them. It was no good getting rid of the food, because any left over, they would get a part of the inheritance. So he had to have the whole family.
The police put Jeremy under surveillance.
The best things in life are free, but you can give them to the birds and bees. I want money.
They found he was busy flogging off the family silver and partying hard.
That's what I want.
Jeremy had thrown a party in Holland somewhere, spent £6,000 on a hotel bill, put it against the farm account. He then went off and had a beano celebrations at some yacht club at Burnham. Not the signs of a grieving son.
But Jeremy soon spent all the family's ready cash, so he dreamt up a scam involving his sister Sheila, nicknamed Bambi by the tabloids, a scam that sealed his fate.
We got a call from Jeremy Bamber's friend, Brett Collins, saying that Jeremy Bamber had some photographs to sell of his late sister, and would we, the Sun newspaper, be interested in buying them? It was a bizarre situation. We were in an oldie-worldie pub, and we were talking about the photos. What were they, and what did they show? Well, there's apparently shots with a vibrator and with a cucumber being used as a sex toy. And would the son be interested in buying them? They said, well, we want cash and we'd like it to conclude this very quickly. I never did see the photographs, I must say, so whether they existed or not, I don't know. I reported back to the office what the situation was and got a message back from the editor, turn the bastard over. We did a front page story next day saying Jeremy Bamber tries to sell porno pictures of his sister. I was appalled. You've got this, very cool young man, but completely unperturbed by the facts of the situation, all these, the massacre, these dead people, people that had given him a home, completely unconcerned about them. He talked about Bambi particularly as a kind of inanimate object, it wasn't a sister that he'd known and loved. He seemed completely unconcerned about them as people. He wanted money and he wanted it quick.
Jeremy was oblivious to the fact that evidence was mounting up against him. He just carried on partying. Let me take you to the place where membership's a smiling
face. Shoulders with the stars. He went to Saint-Tropez and he had a holiday with his friend, a male friend. There, two police officers actually went out and they actually monitored what he was doing and where he was. And when he came back from his holiday in Saint-Tropez, the minute he reached Dover, they arrested him.
On September 29th, 7 weeks after a crime that shocked the nation, Jeremy Bamber was finally charged with the murder of all five of his family. But despite all the evidence, Jeremy still maintained he was innocent.
This man could not have committed those murders. It is impossible.
On the 2nd of October 1986, Jeremy Bamber was finally brought to trial in Chelmsford Crown Court for the murder of five members of his family.
It was an incredible story. You couldn't contrive a situation like that, you know, if you were a fictional crime writer. But here it was being played out for real in a court of law.
Despite the evidence against him, Jeremy Bamber claimed he was innocent and the murders had been committed by his adopted sister, Sheila. Stan Jones had questioned Bamber for hours, but he had never confessed.
I'd ask him a question, and sometimes he'd basically sing the answer. He'd go, yes or no, in a melodious tone, which really wore me out, and then he kept staring at me. Most strange chap to talk to, another world. I'd never forget, he had a white Aran jumper, and he'd pull out the hairs, all the cotton bits, and floss his teeth with it, and put it between his teeth and twing it like a guitar, and he was really, well, another person. I've interviewed a lot of people, but that was some interview.
But many people still believed Bamber was innocent.
We had a fight on our hands. We actually felt we needed to put the point across that he was guilty, and to convince the rest of the world that he was. I stared at him compulsively, and I was told if I didn't stop doing it, they wouldn't let me in. So I had to stop doing it. I wasn't allowed to look at him other than the occasional glimpse or the, you know, like that. So, but no, I really wanted to let him know I was there.
As the trial started, the prosecution only had a few key pieces of evidence to rely on. First was the silencer that David had found hidden in the gun cupboard. The forensic investigation had found Sheila Keffel's blood inside the silencer.
There's no way in a million years could she shoot herself twice, bearing in mind she's upstairs in the bedroom, bring the silencer down and put it back in the cupboard, and then go upstairs to die. There's no way in a million years that could happen. Impossible.
The second piece of evidence was the testimony of Julie Mugford, Bamber's ex-girlfriend. She said Bamber had told her all his plans to kill the family. The case hung in the balance. Would the jury decide she was a jealous woman lying to hurt her ex-lover? Or was she an innocent party, terrified into silence by the man she loved?
She was a fantastic witness. Basically, she stuck to her story. And when he buried him, I took hundreds of pages of statements from Julie over a period of time. And she most probably got out nearly all that in evidence. Julie said, why do you want to kill a family? Jeremy said to her, well, they've all got to go. He said, my dad's getting old and decrepit. My mother is a religious freak. Sheila is paranoid schizophrenic. And her twins would be brought up in no good way. And he thought, well, if I get rid of the whole lot of them, I'm doing everybody a favour.
The prosecution argued that he'd killed his entire family from pure greed. By wiping them out, he had inherited around £500,000.
He wanted his money from the estate. No, not later. Because as Julie Mugford said, why can't you wait? You know, in a few years' time, when your parents are old, you'll get the farm. You'll be laughing, you know, you have the whole business. And he basically said, I can't wait that long. I want it now. They treat me like nothing.
In the end, the jury had to decide who was telling the truth, Julie Mugford or Jeremy Bamber. After a day, they still couldn't decide. so the judge decided to allow a majority verdict. They convicted Bamber 10-2.
I just wept and wept for about 5 or 6 minutes, and at the end of it all, no one had won, really. We'd lost everyone we loved. He'd lost his freedom. So no one in the whole system had won.
The judge sentenced Bamber to a minimum of 25 years in prison. He called him evil beyond belief. But was the judge right? Was Jeremy Bamber truly evil?
I think the judge got it pretty well as close to the knuckle as you can get it. I don't think you can do much worse than kill both your parents, your sister, and her two children. I can't think of anything much more evil, can you?
Kerry Danes believes Bamber could kill his family so coldly because he has a personality disorder.
He certainly ticks an awful lot of the boxes for a psychopath. Here is somebody who is grandiose, he's arrogant, he seems to have very little emotion, and what he does is very shallow and rather fake. He manipulates other people, and he's quite happy to use people to meet his own needs.
Psychopaths have very little fear or empathy. They do not understand morality, so killing even their own families is easy for them. Being a psychopath would not make you insane. Bamber is still legally guilty of his crimes. But even after 20 years, Bamber says he's innocent. His legal representative is Giovanni Di Stefano, who says he also represents Saddam Hussein and Kenneth Noy.
This man is convicted at the moment of murdering 5 people. So accepting that conviction, and the psychiatrists have to base themselves upon a court decision, they say he's, you know, a psychopath. Yeah. You know, technically they're right. You know, as a matter of clinical analysis, they must be right. But then you must ask, do you accept the conviction? Did he do it?
Giovanni Di Stefano says vital evidence was withheld from Bamber's original defence team. This includes a photo of Sheila taken at 9 a.m. on the morning of the crime. By 9 a.m, Bamber had already been in police custody for 5 hours.
The close-up of blood flowing and pouring from Sheila Caffell's neck. Well, of course, that tells you that she died within an hour and a half, 2 hours of the photograph being taken, taking us to 6:30, 7 o'clock, maybe 5, maybe at its worst, but definitely not more. So it could not, Bamber could not have murdered her. It's impossible.
Bamber's legal team also say they've found a photo of what might be a suicide note in a Bible next to Sheila's body.
In the Bible, there is a letter. Now, that could be a suicide letter. That was never disclosed. After the trial, that Bible was destroyed by the police. Heaven knows why.
And if Sheila didn't do it, Giovanni Di Stefano believes the family were the victims of a government conspiracy.
You have the friends of Nevill Bamber. 5 people between 1953 and 1973, all who worked for the security services, as certainly Mr. Bamber did during the war. Those 5 people all mysteriously died. And I take the view that there are some undercurrents within the, you know, within this trial. That there's a state involvement because too many people are covering up. There's too much non-disclosure. This man could not have committed those murders. It is impossible.
The Essex Police and the Crown Prosecution Service strenuously deny they withheld evidence from Bamber's defence team. And some people think Bamber is appealing not because he is innocent, but because he is bored.
He will continue to protest his innocence, I'm sure he will, for the rest of his time in prison. I can't ever see a day when Jeremy Bamber will put up his hand and say, yeah, OK, I did it, yeah, OK. Can't ever see that happening.
I believe that in the past, he has coped with overwhelming emotions by simply cutting off from them. And really, he's done the same thing in response to his offences. Denial of his offences is the biggest form of cutting off you can have. In his mind, he probably believes that he really didn't do it.
After the trial, the Home Secretary extended Bamber's sentence to the maximum possible, life without parole. Around 20 people in the UK are serving whole life sentences. They include the serial killers Ian Brady and Dennis Nielsen.